So again, I've had the great pleasure of Paul Meenan joining us at college today, and he's brought in a box of tricks. What have you brought in for us today?
So this was brand new, literally. This is an arc fault detection simulator rig, which shows us, allows us to create arcs on MCB protected circuits, arcs on RCD protected circuits, and also the Eaton AFDD Plus, which is really insightful, especially for your learners here today.
And you're only going to see the content developed by Paul on this rig and your trip to Vienna on the E5 group channel on YouTube.
Yes, that's available on our channel.
However, Paul did put me right, because I've used, and you're going to see the footage in a minute, the Dash Wacan 2000 that David Savery brought into us. And I thought I was creating an arc, Paul. What was I creating?
You were effectively creating a glowing spark at best.
So the video you're just about to see, please do not think it's a failure of the device.
No, it's an awesome device. I want one.
Okay, it's the failure of the people creating what we thought was an arc when we actually created a spark. So let's see the footage that me and David did, but let's just think it's actually not an arc, even though we keep saying arc. It's actually, as Paul quite rightly said, actually what, Paul?
It's a spark, basically.
So let's look at the sparks I made.
Hello, it's David from David Savery Electrical Services.
Tresham College have only gone and got David Savery to come into us today, and it's in front of a live audience, so let's hear the live audience go! Yeah. Welcome, David.
Thank you very much. Pleased to be here.
David's kindly come up from Leamington Spa, and he's bought the Dash Wacker. No, Dash...
That's Wacan.
But we've had a little modification. What are we on now?
We're on 2000 now, because we have the addition, I'm afraid, of Patrick from SpongeBob SquarePants, which is the only Lego brick I'm afraid I could find.
We've added a double socket outlet, so we can increase the current it's drawing, and we've got the same arc fault detection device that you used, which is from Crabtree. Agreed?
Yes, an Electrium product.
Okay, so what we're going to do is we're going to bring the camera in, and we're going to see if we can create an arc that can activate the device. We're going to increase the current to see if that will make any difference. We may have to add a solution on to increase that arc as well.
We may have to cheat, because it's quite tricky to get working.
Let's bring the camera in and see this AFDD in action.
Well, I think we're not using the super adjustment mechanism, are we? Because we found that rocking it around actually seems to have a bit more success with creating any kinds of arcs and sparks.
It certainly does.
We've got no load.
So we're going to be wobbling it like so and trying to create a serial arc. Do you agree?
Yes, absolutely. Obviously, this completely flies in the face of safe isolation, so we don't want to try this at home.
We certainly won't be. And just to reiterate, off camera, we've both got our glasses on.
Oh,
okay,
yeah.
So any arc being created will not be damaging the retinas within our eyes. Okay, so we're currently on in the consumer's unit. Our arc fault detection device by Crabtree is energised. I'm assuming it's turned on, and we've got no load, so hence we're creating absolutely no arc, because we've got no current being drawn at the moment. What sort of load are we going to introduce now, David?
Would you like to try one heater first of all at 2 kilowatts?
Yeah, so let's introduce that. So we've now got one heater on.
And if we give it a little bit of technical adjustment, we can... It's very hard to sustain an arc, even with this precision apparatus, but we can see some arc events happening here. Albeit very brief ones, there's nothing that's sort of zigzagging along. There's a bit of smoke coming off as well, isn't there?
There is. So we've got an arc, so that could be a connection maybe in a termination that isn't tight, and it's rocking around in there creating what is a serial arc.
Absolutely, it's all the elements of a loose connection here.
Absolutely.
Although at present, there's nothing to trip it off.
So of course, decent-ish arc, we're drawing 2 kilowatts, we can see clearly there's a break in the cable simulating a serial arc, and nothing's happening.
No, obviously it's not going to trouble the traditional protective devices like your RCD or your circuit breaker. It's not an overload fault, it's not a fault to earth. It is just a serial loose connection at this point, which is causing some high temperature, very localised high temperature. In fact, it's almost welding
together.
Yeah,
welding itself together there, that'd be handy.
Yeah.
Right, let's turn that 2 kilowatt off then. So we're gonna increase the current being drawn now. So we're gonna put 2 heaters in circuit. So we're now gone up to 4 kilowatts.
Indeed, yeah. Four kilowatts of heating on the warmest February day on record.
That was yesterday, wasn't it? Yeah, so we're trying to break that record today. So we're attached by the side of us, 2 heaters. What do you expect to happen now, David?
Well, I've not tested it with that kind of load before, so it'd be nice to actually see it detect that, that there is that kind of fault signature there and to trip off. Whether it will or not, we'll just have to try it, won't we?
Well, let's go for it then. So if I turn on both heaters now, so we should have 4 kilowatts of load.
Oh, that's certainly an angrier looking arc, and it's definitely sort of welding itself together a bit more.
smoke coming off as well.
Effectively.
Yeah, it's trying to stick itself together.
It's good that we got our goggles on because this localised light is very bright.
Oh. Yeah, it's just
it's trying to work to sort of move it because they're just
sticking itself together. And can we suggest that it's activated the arc fault detection device at this stage, David?
Well, I certainly wouldn't want to touch it myself. These connections here, they do still look energised to me.
Yeah, so the other risk is obviously we've got a Oh, wow, that was a good one. Didn't do anything, still going. We've got a massive risk of fire as well, haven't we? So if we've got something that's susceptible.
Pulling it apart actually seems to be a bit more...
Create the bigger arc.
Yeah, a bit more impressive than when they touch together, but...
Again, so... Oh, we're trying. But, of course, if this was in electrical installation, loose termination may be in, instantaneous water heater drawing something near 4 kilowatts.
Yeah, absolutely.
We're not going to want this arc present for a long period of time, and the problem being insulation would start to break down. Massive risk of fire as well.
It would. I mean, you can see the charring on the edges of the wires there. Obviously, if this were in an installation on a higher rated appliance, then you would expect a bit of arcing should the isolator be used, say if it were on a water heater or something like that.
Okay,
but what we have here, you'd think that you'd expect to see something a bit more protective happen.
So what we'll do is if we turn it off now, I'm going to introduce a clip on our meter and let's see what current we were drawing from this load. So we're all set and ready to go. So if you want to turn us back on, David, let's see what we're drawing. So we have got, let's look at the RMS value, and we are drawing, is that 17 amps? 17 yeah. point?
Seven, nearly 18 amps.
Yeah, nearly 18 amps of current. So if we want to try again, let's see if we can see that current drop off, and then I'm back on again. So we're off, back on.
Oof. It's all a bit fiery and fizzy.
Oh yeah, that's another good one. Wow. So we're creating some decent size arcs here. We're drawing almost 18 amps. We've got a serial arc.
I've broken it.
Oh no. 3000 will solve that problem.
It works better without that connector.
Again, the device is not operating, is it?
Certainly haven't seen it do so today, and yet there's some rather high temperature localized.
Previously, when you did it, you then went to a third stage. Obviously, we've increased the current being drawn, but what was the third stage?
Well, the third stage was to cheat and to apply some water to the thing. Now, the thing is with something like a damaged cable, if the cable's got a cut in it or something like that, then some of the medium other than air with its insulation resistance may get in there like water. So it's not completely unrealistic to see water or some of the medium, dust, debris, whatever, get into where a cable's been damaged and where... connections have been exposed.
But we're increasing the event activities required in to cause it to operation. So we're saying not only now we've got to have a serial arc, we've got a serial arc at 2 kilowatts and then 4 kilowatts, we haven't got it to operate. And now we're saying we may have to introduce moisture in order. So this starts becoming slightly ineffective at the moment, maybe at 4 kilowatts. It might be fantastic at 8. It might, if this had been an 8 kilowatt load of shower or something like that, we might have got a massive arc and got it to go straight away. But I think we'll introduce the moisture and
we're
see
increasing
what happens.
The parameters, aren't we, as to what we need to be in place for this thing to actually operate.
I don't think when they sold the devices, they said you must have a certain amount of current being drawn, a certain type of arc, moisture must be present, and it must be a Wednesday at 4:15 in order for it to operate the arc fault section of this device. So we're going to stop now. We're going to introduce some water in the next stage. So we've introduced some moisture, and we're going to try again to see if we can create an arc large enough to operate our arc fault detection device. So are we ready to energise?
Ready to energise.
Okay, so I'm worried now. You notice now I'm using the hands.
Wonder if the water's dropped off.
Should we add a little bit more?
Yeah, water and electricity, that's what we need.
So turning off, we're off by the way, introducing a pipette full of water here. Precision instrument of, yep, that's it. Exactly the right amount.
Okay, ready?
Oh, we had a big drop there, didn't we? Yeah, How long did you spend when you did it before?
It was a good couple of hours of messing around. Maybe the salt was an essential ingredient.
Yeah, so we might need a bit of salt. Okay, so we can see so we've now got a number of factors in place, haven't we? We've got a serial arc, we've got the ingress of moisture, we've got a 4 kilowatt load, yeah. And yet to meet the requirements of the arc fault detection device in order to get it to operate. So they're classing these as good arcs. Is that true?
Well, I presume that the little brain inside the thing is seeing it as a good arc, like a switching arc or that off a contactor. But to me, it looks more like the symptoms of a loose connection.
Yeah, I'm trying to balance it there on the side of it and just fractionally pull it away before it welds, as if we've got a... So we've got a nice... that's got to be... That would be a switch, wouldn't it, for a period of time, just arcing away. I can't see that being a good arc.
I mean, you can see that if that were a switch with a loose connection, the localised damage already being caused by the conductors overheating. If it carried on for long enough, you'd start seeing the plastic insulation nearest the copper degrade, but also the copper itself from starting to get sooty.
I think what we ought to do next is have the introduction of now maybe another element. Do you think that's salt?
Another ingredient.
So
just to demonstrate the thing in action.
Absolutely. It might be that the manufacturer has classed this as an arc that's good. Obviously, I'm not suggesting it's a faulty piece of equipment or anything like that, but we're not managing to create an arc that would be one that the device would see and operate, which is a bit of a shame. So let's stop again and see if we can introduce maybe a salt solution now. Right. Okay then, David, fingers crossed, we've got some salty water solution now stuck there. We may need to introduce it as we're going along, as we need to get a little bit more on there. We're going to reintroduce the 4 kilowatt load.
Okay, ready to energise.
Yeah, I'll take it. I'm doing this one again.
Very Star Trek. Well, if we perhaps use the wheel.
Do you reckon?
That wasn't it. Let me just splay that out a bit more and see if we can't get it to it. Yeah, sorry. As soon as I said that, I thought...
we'll do that one again. Yep. Do you want to stop them both?
That won't be the first time. last time today.
It's okay. Okay then, David. So we've introduced, hopefully, a salt water solution now. I think you're going to try and use the wheel in order to rotate it in and out. We've got 4 kilowatts of load.
Okay, we are powered on.
We're going to have another go.
Ooh.
Wow.
Made me jump. Yeah, despite the heat and the smoke and the...
And that massive first arc.
the sparks jumping off it.
Shall we reintroduce some more?
I think we're going to have to.
Okay, let's go again. So if we pull it back, safely isolated. Of course, the precision measuring tool here of a cup of...
Safe as isolation can get when you're pouring salt water onto exposed copper.
Yeah, that's the one. Really? it still didn't go.
You can hear the old hum of the heaters powering there, can't you?
I can feel them on my leg as well. Okay, shall we introduce some more? We're going to get one going now.
Does it?
Did you at any point lose the will to live when you were doing it the first time around?
Yes, I did.
Okay, so a little bit more. Okay, I'm confident this time. That is saturated.
That looks impressive this time.
Yeah, look at that. It's going to drop straight onto there. We go. Watch out, boys. No.
It's welded itself together.
Okay,
so it's actually fixed its own loose connection there.
Okay. Shall we try a little bit more again?
Let's just adjust that slightly again.
So I'm just going to move this slightly for a better view. My students are watching this on the big screen, we would say. So here we go. I think we've got a tiny bit more in here. It's a big, oh, that's dripping. Let's go for it.
Surely this time.
Surely. No.
Come on. I mean, it doesn't get much more archy than that, does it? It's welded it again.
Okay. So I think we can.
I can't,
Well, we solved the problem.
Yeah, there we go.
Okay, so if you ever want to weld two copper conductors together, I can recommend the Dash Wacan, is it? I can't see that yet. 2000, and I can recommend saltwater solution. And I think we've solved all our problems. So, what do you reckon? One more last little go?
Are we out of water?
No. We can persevere.
We can go all day on this. We've all got all day, haven't we?
We have. I'm going to make it very, very... off screen, I've managed to get the required mixture of water and salt.
Spread it out a little bit more. I might actually get a bit more.
You can't see it, but with a terminal screwdriver, I'm stirring the water and salt solution together. Okay. Dave is making the necessary modifications.
Right.
Here we go. This is definitely going to be the one. Oh, I think I've got more on the... Oh, that's a good one. Gone. Enough of an arc to cause a massive fire, but not quite enough to cause the arc fault detection device to operate. Oh, that slide didn't work. I reckon we introduced some liquid down.
Maybe.
Do you reckon? Is that still freely moving?
Yeah.
Okay.
It was.
Okay.
Makes for a good indoor firework, but
okay,
not the best demonstration.
Yeah. So I think we can summarise this, that we didn't have the right conditions. Let's be fair to the device. So we're looking at the Crabtree AFDD. So the arc we were creating, would you agree, is not one of the signature arcs that this device will pick up?
Because seems not.
Since it didn't pick it up, yeah. We're looking at a 4 kilowatt load. We're looking at a heavy current of nearly 18 amps. We've had a serial arc. We've introduced moisture. We've introduced salty moisture. And we still haven't created an arc. And we've seen some very big arcs. We still haven't created an arc, David, that was one that would cause the device to operate. Would you say maybe it's looking for a bigger current drawing capacity? Maybe an 8, 9, 10 kilowatt shower would be something that would create an arc bigger?
Perhaps. I mean, certainly if I was going to fit one of these devices, it would more likely be on a higher current, higher load circuit, such as an electric shower.
Yeah.
Especially where loose connections can cause some localized heating effects. But even so, this is the symptom of a loose connection here. I would expect to have seen something happen today.
Yeah.
Even if the smaller arcs were perhaps interpreted as being switching events by the device, having water on your electrics and it rubbing around to the point where it's getting so hot the copper's welding together, I'd have thought would have
generated an arc that it would have seen.
Yeah,
absolutely. So it's in its infancy. Let's not throw it under the bus. Obviously, this is an emerging technology. It's not currently a requirement of the regulations. I'd like to think the time they may introduce it as a requirement that the actual technology is caught up with the actual idea. Would that be a statement you agree with?
Yeah, it'd be interesting to see where it goes as well. Obviously, this is a two-module unit because you have an RCBO paired up with the AFDD unit. But I understand that this year they're going to be coming out with a unit this size, the RCBO size that contains the technology. Which makes it obviously easier to retrofit into existing consumer units as well, because as it stands, apart from these Starbreaker devices, it's very difficult to retrofit this into an existing consumer unit because you've got to modify the buzz bar.
Okay, so in summary then, emerging technology, we've got to create a certain type of arc, which we never managed to do with this fantastic piece of equipment with a 4 kilowatt load.
A shame, but yes, that appears to be the case today.